Realities of real people and everyday life down on Main Street.
Well, welcome, folks. Here we are once again, Core Brain Journal, and we are so happy today. It's a real privilege to me, for me, to be introducing you to Dr. Peter Osborne. A lot of you don't know him, and the reason to really be tuned into Core Brain Journal here is we're introducing a lot of interesting people that really are over in one different fold that have very constructive things to say about brain healing, brain science, and options that will work, even though perhaps you didn't think they would work. And that's certainly been the story of my life. And I know it's been the story of Peter's life, because you can see in his writings and what he comments on that he's had some surprises out there as well. So I'm just going to say quickly, Peter, a brief introduction, and then we'll go ahead and talk. Let's start in our conversation. So he's the clinical director of Origins Healthcare in Sugar Land, Texas. Sounds like a great spot in the world. He's a chiropractic medical doctor, board certified clinical nutritionist, and is also an expert in orthomolecular and functional pastoral medicine. Now that's a mouthful. That's a lot going on there, Peter. And I do hope you'll help amplify on that in just a moment. But since 2001, his clinical focus has been on holistic natural treatment of chronic degenerative diseases, with a primary focus on gluten sensitivity and food allergies. I know we're going to get into that, because I'm looking forward to talking. And his practice involves the utilization of dietary change to impact neurologic diseases that do affect the brain. So brain inflammation is a term that Dr. Osborne uses to describe the effects that gluten has on the brain. And he's helped literally thousands of patients recover from mysterious medical illnesses by understanding that connection. So without further ado, thanks a lot for joining us, Peter. We're really happy having you here.
Hey, love being here. Thanks so much for having me on.
So what would you say, that was a kind of a lengthy thing, but what would you say to just bring it right down to where the rubber meets the road, Peter? What's in that whole history of where you're going and who you are, what would you say is the highlight of what you're doing right now?
Honestly, the highlight for me is every day seeing a patient in the clinic get better. I'm very passionate about doing clinical work. I've contemplated a number of times, because I have a rather large online following of subscribers, and could probably, like many doctors decide to do, they decide to leave the clinic and just kind of focus on educating the masses. But to me, all we can do by educating the masses is broad general strokes. We can't get specific. We can't dive deep into the unique biochemistry of the individual. And I love that part, because that's where I keep my edge. That's where I get to hug somebody who gets better. That's where I get to keep my human connection. And I just love that part of being a doctor.
Well, I think that is so important. And I think the thing that you were thinking but didn't quite say, because I know you from our previous conversations, is the learning process. If you're out there on the edge, on the road where these things are actually happening, you will find that it didn't turn out as you expected it would. And you will have to dig deeper with that person. And that person will teach you something you didn't know. And that's another reason to be out there.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, going back to the fundamental premise of, doctor meaning to be teacher, and teacher is, to me, I define a teacher as a perpetual student. And as the student, we learn from our students, who are our patients, if we're open toward that learning. If we shut it off and we close it out, we won't learn. But I think, the clinic offers that opportunity to be in school every day.
Well, it's really participatory medicine is what we're talking about, is respect for the individual, teaching them so well that they can tell you if you're wrong.
And that's right.
They can tell you if you're wrong in a meaningful way. That's what happens to me. I'm going to tell you, this is what I think it is. This is the way I think it is. And if I'm wrong, you better tell me, because there's no way I'm going to get it if you don't tell me. And then we wind up having some fun with it. So, and you've written a very interesting book regarding the gluten thing. Let me just bring this up, because this is a little side venture, and I'd love for you to explain it to me, because you know a heck of a lot more about this than I do. In my office, we do a lot of IgG testing. We're very, very interested in it, because exactly what you're saying has been one of the most transformational periods in my life in terms of really understanding what's going on, because I, like most traditional psychs, have been interested for years in the DSM-5. Here's what the label is, here's what we chase, and really it's a dance of appearances. It's not really what's going on. It's a little bit about what's going on, but it's woefully insufficient when you get into the biomedical causality issues. And what I've done in the testing, I've seen a lot of individuals, and I jokingly called it the New Jersey trifecta. I saw three problems arise with IgG testing. Milk number one, eggs number two, and gluten a slow third. So casein, eggs, and gluten a slow third. I said, that's the trifecta. Now, tell me anything you can about why that is so, and am I missing something? Because a lot of you folks who know a lot more than I do are really focused very much on gluten, whereas casein has been the big thing that I've been finding in my office as a primary source of immune dysfunction. What's your thought about that?
Well, I don't disagree with casein being a major player. One of the things that has been being studied with casein that relates to gluten is the way that dairy is processed. And so, for example, if you look at, you go to the store and you buy a gallon of milk or a thing of yogurt, a package of cheese, one of the enzymes that gets added when we have these mass industrialized scale food farms where we're driving high levels of milk to produce milk byproduct, one of the things that happens on the back end that people don't know about because it's not on the food label is this enzymatic process of preserving the dairy. And there's this enzyme called MTG, microbial transglutaminase. Mm-hmm. And if you recognize transglutaminase as actually one of the types of tests that we run to measure for gluten sensitivity or celiac disease, the anti-tissue transglutaminase.
Right.
But microbial transglutaminase is an enzyme. It's derived from microbes, and we use it to thicken dairy and to preserve its shelf life. And interestingly enough, some researchers have found that when you add MTG to casein, it makes casein look more like gluten. And so now we get this, what some doctors in some clinics and some labs are referring to as a cross-reactivity of the protein, meaning the protein structures are similar enough that if the immune system's already heightened and alerted to one of them, and then we bring in the other that has a very similar structure, then it's recognizing that other protein and kind of having a similar type reaction. So that's one aspect to dairy. Now, the other aspect that I see and that I've contemplated on, I can't confirm it with research, but I can certainly dwell and think on it, and that is the way we actually feed the cow itself. Most of these cows are being fed primarily corn as their staple food in their diet, and many believe that corn is not gluten, or that corn does not contain gluten. Corn actually does contain a form of gluten, and in 2012 it was found that corn gluten reacts with the genetic receptors in people with gluten sensitivity more aggressively than wheat gluten does. It's just that corn is lower in concentration in gluten than wheat is, so. Mm-hmm. A lot of people don't make that correlation, but the cow is being fed this, this staple food of grain. And, what happens next is the cow produces milk. So nobody's studied whether or not gluten from the cow's diet passes through into the cow's milk, but it's been studied in humans, and we know that gluten passes through mothers. So, but the difference is the chambers, right? We humans have a one-chambered stomach, and so we don't have all this extra ability to digest and ferment and everything else the way a cow's stomach does. So I'm waiting on somebody, some great researcher somewhere, to pick the ball up on that and actually to study it for us so that we can confirm it one way or the other. But that's one of my other kind of working theories on dairy. And then the other aspect to that has to do with this this pesticide called Roundup or glyphosate. Mm-hmm. And what we're finding and what we're seeing is that it actually, a lot of what we think might be gluten sensitivity has a lot to do with glyphosate as one of the big factors in grain today. Today, the way fields are harvested, they're sprayed with Roundup initially, and then right before harvest, they're sprayed again. So there's a much higher concentration of this pesticide, which we know can cause leaky gut and subsequently you know, once you penetrate the gut barrier, the blood-brain barrier gets to open up, and now you can start affecting people neurologically as well. So there's kind of three running things that I look at as dairy is associated with. And one is that enzymatic treatment of dairy causing it to mimic gluten. The other is the fact that we feed cows primarily gluten-based food and then extrapolate their milk as a staple food in our diet. And the third is just that this pesticide, which we can find in the dairy as well, can actually look like gluten and mimic it.
That is so doggone interesting. Thanks very much for sharing it. I mean, it's a big, the curtain parted right there. We have a serious set of information there. I'm thinking why I'm hesitating right there is what I'm struggling with is, does that casein that's marked that way cause physiologic changes in the gut as the gluten does? In other words, is it just a marker issue, or is the milk actually causing a problem beyond just the marker issue?
Well, I think it could certainly cause a problem in the gut if it looks like gluten. And one of the side effects is that we actually get an immune response against the gut cells, and villus atrophy and flattening follow, which can then lead to malabsorption syndromes. And you know, if we chase that down its rabbit hole, malabsorption, let's just use vitamin B12 as an example. If we damage the cells in the GI tract responsible for absorbing B12, and we end up inducing a B12 deficiency, and B12 deficiency causes depression, and B12 deficiency causes anemia, which can lead to lack of oxygen supply to the brain. So now we can get, you know, the neurological sequelae of low oxygen, which can then in turn raise blood pressure. You know, so now we've got this patient who, you know, chronically food has damaged their nutrition. The doctors want to put them on blood pressure medication, so they do. And blood pressure medication inhibits CoQ10, which causes brain atrophy. And so now we're chasing this one symptom to not really come to a resolution of why the actual problem existed in the first place. So it kind of creates this big mess. It becomes muddled, you know, because after that proverbial patient gets hammered with blood pressure pills, and then subsequently maybe after that diabetic pills, and subsequently after that, you know, maybe cholesterol lowering medication. By the time we get to them in the clinic, they've been on medications that have interfered with their innate biochemistry for 5, 6, 7, 10 years. So that in and of itself is a mess that has to be kind of, you know, catered to. But then you have all the other things that could be wrong with their biochemistry, what foods they may or may not be reacting to. You've kind of got to figure all those pieces of the puzzle out. And then you've got to apply it. And then you've got to allow for enough time of that application to manifest as a result, whether it's negative or positive in your patient, so that you can make the next decision about how to move forward with them.
You're dealing with the complexity, and it's a chronic complexity. So many people come in and want a quick fix. You know, and I always tell them, look, you got a chronic condition. You can't take a chronic condition and turn it around, because a chronic condition by just definition is a complexity of things, and it takes a chronic cure. You can't just go and it's going to happen in 2 weeks or whatever. I mean, we've been really interested in Walsh's work. I don't know if you're following Bill Walsh and all his methylation work and so on. I mean, it got very, very interesting, because then you have not only I think of that New Jersey trifecta as the tip of Mount Everest. And then I look at Candida down there at the tree line. And then when you get down into the neuroscience swamp, I mean, the neurotransmitter swamp down at the bottom, you know, we're looking at all methylation and these other things. All of them are downstream from just whatever that IgG issue was up at the top. I really appreciate you sharing with us the milk, because then it raised the question for me when you said it. But what you're really saying, in summary, you said a lot of important, I'm trying to say the right word without sounding critical, because I don't think our audience is right where you are with the language. You know, you were popping out a lot of stuff very quickly there. But it was reassuring to know that what you did say was that if a milk shows on an IgG or an egg shows on an IgG, it's going to be better for that patient to really follow that diet, because you could still have the villus atrophy and so on, the breakdown of the bowel, that it wouldn't work effectively as a consequence, regardless of the cause of that IgG marker. Is that correct?
That's correct. Yeah, and I would even go even one step further with dairy, as you've mentioned, kind of the big three, the dairy, the egg, and the gluten. You know, you look at the dairy, And the trend there, if we want to tie it to the gluten, is that the dairy is so similar to gluten for many reasons. But then the egg, what do we feed the chicken? So you go back to, again, the diet of the animal and the way the animal's raised. Now, most birds today, most chickens are not, you know, they're not pasture raised on a farm where they're eating grass and worms and insects. They're, you know, chicken's origin is as a jungle bird, where that's primarily what they would eat. They're primarily eating corn and wheat and other grains as well. So wondering whether or not there's a correlation between diet and reactivity. And what I'm also waiting to see is whether or not, if somebody were to take, for example, a pasture egg where the bird was fed real food that bird is supposed to eat, and grass-fed dairy from non-recombinant bovine growth hormone added milk, right? So just real food, basically, from animals who are eating what the animals are supposed to eat, and comparatively analyze when we're doing these IgG tests, distinctly say, okay, I'm testing in this scenario, I'm testing the egg from this type of animal, and in this scenario, I'm testing the egg from the other kind of animal to see if there's a distinct difference. Nobody's really ever come out and done that. And I think that's one of the reasons why we have so much variance in food allergy testing as well, because, you know, what's being tested is not necessarily what's being eaten.
Peter, that is so interesting. I really appreciate your sharing that. It's very deep thought about where we are. We're at one place right now. I mean, it's been so illuminating for me to just even be doing this kind of testing, and we've seen so many people get well. But I still have the question in the back of my mind. I've done everything right. I've made the recommendations. We follow the test recommendations. We've done a variety of different tests, and yet there's still something not quite there that I can't predict what it is. You know, what's causing the problem. So what would you say if you did IgG testing, methylation? You looked at methylation really carefully. I don't know where you are with methylation, but I think the methylation discussion is going past MTHFR.
And yeah, well beyond that, for sure.
So then you've done all that and you're looking at that. What's the next thing that you see on the horizon that's, oh my gosh, that's the next thing I really have to do that I haven't really pursued effectively? Do you have any thoughts about that one?
Well, I'm going to answer that two ways. One is I'm going to answer it in a way that I have pursued it effectively in this sense, and that is redefining what gluten actually means. I mean, one of the principal reasons I wrote No Grain, No Pain was to really try, in layman's terms, to describe what gluten actually is, but in research terms, effectively describe it so that doctors better understand it, so that they quit giving patients the wrong bit of information. Because I think where a lot of patients go wrong on a gluten-free diet is they go to the gluten-free food aisle and they buy the gluten-free bread and crackers and pasta. And what ends up happening in these individuals, we've coined it gluten-free whiplash, is because they cut out a lot of gluten from their diet, but they're still getting other forms of gluten, and they start to get sick again. And it generally takes about 2 to 3 months. It's actually happening quicker now as the gluten-free food industry grows. We've seen it happen much, much faster. And we've actually seen it in many cases where patients just don't even respond to a gluten-free diet as traditionally defined, meaning a gluten-free diet traditionally defined is wheat, barley, and rye free, and that corn and rice and oats and sorghum and millet are grains that are allowed. And so people run to these other forms of grains, and they just trade one for the other. So they're eating just the same quantity of grain in their diet, and they're getting different forms of gluten because they don't understand fully what gluten is. So that's a big, to me, the biggest needle mover I have ever seen clinically. And you know, I treat patients from all over the world who have seen, you know, on average 10 doctors. And a lot of these patients that I'm seeing have been to some of the best functional medicine doctors in the world, who are not, in my opinion, again, this is my opinion, they're not defining gluten in a manner that's consistent with it being grain-free, because there's no such thing as a grain that doesn't contain gluten. There's only such thing as a grain that cannot contain alpha-gliadin, meaning alpha-gliadin is used, it's the technical term for the gluten protein found in wheat, barley, and rye.
Mm-hmm.
And so doctors, when they're doing testing, like IgG testing and other, they're only measuring alpha-gliadin. So understand that there are 1,000 forms of gluten. Alpha-gliadin is only one of them.
Oh my gosh.
And this is, the problem is so big that just in 2010, we discovered 400 new forms of gluten. 40 of these forms of gluten were more toxic than alpha-gliadin.
That is so interesting. Oh, my gosh.
If our testing is dependent upon measuring gluten as only one kind of gluten found in wheat, barley, and rye, and that testing comes back negative, we could potentially have a very false negative. Now, if the testing comes back positive and we take the diet to the next level, which is going wheat, barley, and rye free, but that patient is truly gluten sensitive at their core, meaning that it's not just alpha-gliadin that's causing the problem, but it's also the gluten in corn and the gluten in rice and the gluten in oats and other forms of grain, then what we're going to see happen is we're going to see a mediocre result. We're going to see some improvement, but we're not going to see a resolution. They're still going to be eating things that are creating that immune response.
I'm so glad I asked you that question. Now, and I apologize for not reading your book. I mean, I've got to go out and get it right now, because you just answered a question that's going on every day in my office, because I'm like, I think I'm doing everything right. And one of the reasons to be doing this kind of work is because it really is, as we said a moment ago, educational. You wind up having these surprises, and I just had a big surprise with you, and thank you for it. And I'm going to definitely read the book, because I've got to tighten up my whole operation. Let's ask you one more key question to help all of us tighten up our operation. Where do you take that information with the patient? How do you actually then write the metaphoric prescription to make it happen for them when you want to take those corrective measures?
So I've actually had to create new terminology. I find that the creating terminology gives a sense of definition and a sense of direction, and so a person can understand it better. But you know, I actually call the gluten-free diet the traditional gluten-free diet and such. So I call it the traditional gluten-free diet. And currently, you're on a traditional gluten-free diet if you're only avoiding wheat, barley, and rye. We call a true gluten-free diet. So I relabel it true gluten-free,
right?
Meaning that it is devoid of all known forms of gluten, because by definition, gluten is the name of the family of proteins found within the seeds of grass. That's what grain is. Grain is the seeds of grass. And so there's no such thing as a seed coming from grass that is gluten-free. There are seeds of grass that are alpha-gliadin-free, but not truly gluten-free.
Wow.
And so what happens, and what I've seen, and I've actually, that's where I compressed all the research that was done to date. So like the name of the gluten found in corn, for example, is called Zain. And it was shown in a number of studies going back to 1968 to cause inflammatory damage in celiac patients. It's actually, corn is one of the, so when we make a diagnosis, understand, when we make a diagnosis of celiac disease, which sometimes is used synonymously with gluten sensitivity, but they're not the same thing. Everybody with celiac disease is gluten sensitive, but not everybody with gluten sensitivity will develop celiac disease.
Yes.
So that's kind of the way we have to think about it.
Mm-hmm.
And so if our lab tests are a diagnostic only of celiac disease, then we miss a huge battery of people with gluten sensitivity. But the other issue is this. The lab tests that are diagnostic of celiac disease aren't even truly diagnostic accurately, because corn has been shown to cause villus atrophy, and soy has been shown to cause villus atrophy, and parasitic infection has been shown to cause villus atrophy. So if you're a doctor, a GI doctor, and you're doing the standard kind of care where you run your patient, you scope them, and you biopsy them, and you come back and you have villus atrophy, but you didn't rule out parasite, you didn't rule out corn reactivity, and you didn't rule out soy reactivity, you haven't yet done your homework. You're assuming that villus atrophy is coming from only wheat, barley, or rye, and so you're potentially guiding them down a completely wrong diet. I mean, there's a potential that you're right, but there's a huge potential that you're wrong, or there's also the huge potential that you're right and you're wrong, because if you're only telling them to go wheat, barley, and rye free, but part of their atrophy was soy-based and part of their atrophy was corn-based, or maybe they do have this parasite, so now you've got a very confused patient. So what we've done is we've created new definitional criteria that I make sure that every patient going through the diagnostic process of learning whether or not they have gluten sensitivity issues understands what those definitions are. And we went one step further in our lab testing. And so one of the things that we did, when we look at the immune system and we look at food allergies, we know scientifically there's 7 mechanisms that we know of, probably more, but there's 7 that we know of that are allergic responses. The first is what's called IgE. It's that classic anaphylactic hives, lip swelling, throat constricting reaction.
I call that one the immunoglobulin emergency.
Yeah, there you go. There you go. That's good. I like that.
And IgG is immunoglobulin ghost. I can't even talk at this hour. But so I got the G for ghost because you can't see it, and I got the E for emergency. Sorry to interrupt you. I thought you'd get
no,
a kick
okay.
out of it.
So you've got E and you've got G, but you've also got A.
Mm-hmm.
You've got immunoglobulin M, and you've got D. Now, there's less known about D at this point, but these are definitely antibodies that we can produce in response to a threat. Now, then you've also got a whole other sidearm called immune complex. And you've got another sidearm that's directly from the T cells called a T cell response. Wow. So you know, when you've got all those different potential ways the immune system can respond, if you're only looking at one or two or three, then what ends up happening is you could miss some pieces, miss some elements. But here's the big kicker. So it's not even that. Like, if we look at those seven responses, those are all generally what we would refer to as either an acute response like the emergency IgE or what we would refer to as a humoral immune response, meaning it's the part of our immune system that adapts to the environment. It's kind of like we develop antibodies if we get exposure to measles. That's humoral immunity. But we're born with an immunity called the innate immune system.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And the innate immune system has different chemicals that it uses. It releases different types of weapons that are non-antibody related.
Mm-hmm.
And so we think, most researchers today believe that gluten sensitivity is not a humoral immune response by itself, that it's also an innate immune response. And we've actually proven this in part. There's this receptor in the gut called a toll-like receptor where we see gluten and other proteins found in grains tripping this receptor, which is more of an innate response in the immune system. So it's a different subset of chemicals. And to date, there's not a commercial lab that measures it. Now, on that note, you can measure the gene receptor. The HLA-DQ gene,
yep,
there's two of them. There's alpha one and there's a beta one. And so what they do is they form on the surface of our white blood cells, they form an antenna.
Yep.
And this antenna, its job is to look at things as they're coming through the pipeline. Are you a good guy or a bad guy? And it tells the immune system good versus bad. And so then as it's telling the immune system good or bad, the immune system then has this idea of what it's supposed to attack versus what it's not supposed to attack.
Mm-hmm,
so
mm-hmm.
when I'm looking at making a decision of whether or not a person is gluten sensitive, because we get so much false negative on an IgG response or an IgA response, I strictly look at HLA-DQ genetics. It's kind of like some doctors look at methylation genes. I'm looking at gluten genes, and I'm saying, look, if you have the propensity to react to gluten genetically, the only thing that you need is the trigger to turn the gene on, and the trigger is gluten. So if you have gluten-sensitive genes and you eat gluten, that gluten is going to bind to your genetic receptor, and it's going to trigger an inflammatory cascade response. Whether that cascade is humoral or innate is irrelevant. It still creates inflammation at the end of the day. And as long as you're chronically inflamed, we're not going to be able to heal you. So this allows me to isolate genetically whether or not that person is got the propensity to react to gluten. And I'd much rather know, look, you're better off avoiding gluten as opposed to let's wait 20 years before you develop an autoimmune disease or some type of neurological problem before we actually entertain the idea of looking at diet and what you should or shouldn't be eating.
Peter, that is so doggone interesting. You know, I know a little bit about this. I know a microcosm of what you're talking about. And my memory was it was HLA-DQ8 was the big one, and DQ2 was the, now they, am I remembering that correctly, that those were the
yeah,
two?
HLA-DQ2 and HLA-DQ8 are celiac genes.
Okay.
Now, here's why that's important to differentiate. So a person with HLA-DQ2 or DQ8 is gluten sensitive genetically.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to react to gluten, and it might take 30 years for disease to develop, but they're going to react to it, okay? But there are other subtypes. There's HLA-DQ1, and there's HLA-DQ3, and those are what are referred to as non-celiac gluten-sensitive subtypes.
Oh,
so
my.
Mm-hmm. Now, where that relates to you, and I think where a lot of your work, and it might be helpful, is the DQ1 subtype has been linked to neurological diseases like cerebellar ataxia.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Okay, and vertigo.
Oh my
it's
gosh.
Been linked to diseases like schizophrenia. So here we have, you know, a known genetic pattern that is a gluten-sensitive pattern that has a propensity toward neurological damage versus a propensity toward gastrointestinal damage. Now, in my experience, I haven't seen that T to be 100% true across the board, meaning that if a person has HLA-DQ1 only, that doesn't mean that they're only going to have nerve problems. Yes. I've seen those people develop gut problems too, and I've seen them develop skin problems. Understood. But again, these are just kind of sweeping what we see in a general large populace.
No, I got you. That's great.
Yeah.
And then what about three? Were you going to say something about three?
So HLA-DQ3, in my own clinical experience, more arthritic. So psoriatic arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, I've seen a lot of that. And sometimes I'll actually combine that with HLA-B27, which is another very important gene in the immune system. It's important as a genetic marker for a predisposition to autoimmune arthritides or autoimmune arthritis.
Oh, my gosh. Now, let me ask you. Now I'm going to get right down physician to physician here.
Okay.
What lab do you use to measure this stuff?
That's the problem. So we used to use Kenny Fine, the Entera lab.
Yeah.
And so they do a good job over there. But the problem that I was running into and it was that they only measured the beta 1. So we would only get one of the HLA-DQ genes measured, but there's two of them. So I needed to get the alpha 1 gene measured. And so when I went to some of the major labs across the country, the problem is the way that we're reporting the result is that the way genetics are reported generally is they're reported if they're positive. So in the sense of HLA-DQ testing, a positive result would be an HLA-DQ2 or an HLA-DQ8. And the reason why is that those are the two positive gene associations with celiac disease, and that's where the lab leaves it. They end it at that point. They don't investigate ones or threes. So I actually had to get the lab to create the platform, basically, to be able to test what I needed them to test, and then I could get that result, and I could interpret the allelic data into HLA-DQ2, 8s, 1s, and 3s. So we actually created our own resource for this. That's part of Gluten Free Society. So anybody can use that testing. If they just go to glutenfreesociety.org, there's a link. It says genetic testing. Then they can get that testing done over the internet. It's as easy as a cheek swab. We don't need to take blood, and you can do
amazing.
It anywhere in the world. And so we created that platform to help people get that kind of an answer thoroughly.
That link will be on our episode here. It's definitely going to be there, and we're going to make sure we put that together. Say, we're running out of time very quickly. I love talking to you. We're going to get you back. We're going to do this again because we have so much more to talk about. I mean, the issue is these pieces of information need to be out there with public knowledge. And I really appreciate you taking the time to share that with our audience because it's meaningful, it's useful, and it's going to help somebody's life out down the road. There's no question about it. The next level that I'd like us to talk about is to get into some of the actual experiences you have. We just don't have time for it today because you really gave us a good foundation of science, which is what we need. And we're definitely going to put a link on the episode to your book, and I'm going to read it, and I'm going to write a review. I'm going to put something up there because, you know, I owe this back to you. No question about it. I feel a sense of mutual responsibility. I know you feel responsible, but I feel the same thing. It's like you just explained some problems that I've been having in my practice, and I appreciate that. So
yeah,
I've got
that could be helpful.
Yeah, I just got to learn more. So, in closing, what would you say would be the key thing you would like to leave with our readers? Because we do have to wind up. We're doing that drive time limit. What would be the key item that you would say to our readers? You've said a lot of things here that are extremely important. Thank goodness it's on a recording so they can replay it. But the next level is what would be kind of where you would send somebody to do something. We got Gluten Free Society. We've got that. Do you have any? And the book, we're going to put the link for that. Is there anything else in closing that you would say that's been meaningful for you, that's changed your life, something you really think people need to pay attention to?
I think people really need to. If you walk away from this interview, you know, with any thought process in your head, it's that understand one thing very, very clearly, because very few doctors will validate it, not because it isn't true, but because they just don't understand it.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, food is the ultimate drug. It fits all criteria for how we define what a drug is. It changes the way we think, act, and feel. And so depending on the food, some, you know, it's just like with a drug, a person can take one drug and another person over here could take the exact same drug and have a completely different experience. And I say, open your mind to the thought that as food being a drug, you are a unique individual experiencing that intake of that food. And keep your mind open to the thought process that because food is a chemical, that it could either create a negative response in your body or it could create a positive response in your body. And not everybody's the same. The old adage, one man's food is another man's poison, or one man's trash is another man's treasure, as most people know it by, is very, very important to walk away understanding, because the skepticism on this, as you know, Chuck, is huge. So many doctors, because they lack the knowledge of nutrition, they dismiss it. You know, it's like you go to a doctor, and if you go to an OB-GYN and they think you've got a neurological problem, they refer you to a neurologist. Mm-hmm. But if you go to an OB-GYN and they think you have a nutritional problem, they say, oh, it's not nutritional, don't worry about it. And they don't refer you to a nutritional doctor. They just kind of slip it under the rug. And that's probably one of the biggest threats to healthcare today. So I say walk away from this understanding. You know, my 15 years of experience is knowing that one thing, that one man's food is another man's poison. So never underestimate the power of diet change as a tool to get recovery over a health issue.
And just to amplify on that one little point further, and that is to do the testing that's available. Because if you have any doubt about it, it's there. And you've done a great job telling us some very important things that all of us can use in our practices. I mean, in a way, this was a presentation, a discussion, an interview for colleagues and medical professionals. But what's really true, and you know this to be true from your practice, there are a myriad of individuals out there who are street people, Main Street people, who know this stuff because they've been doing their homework and they need a place to go. And I think one of the things they got to do is they got to read your book, as I do. And I'm looking forward to it, Peter. And for our next conversation, I'll be more informed.
Awesome.
So thanks again for taking the time, Peter. We look forward to it. And Peter's going to have a PDF that we're going to have available for you folks. And that's going to be available at, this one's 005 download is going to be Peter's PDF download. And he's going to have, I don't really know what's going to be on it, but it's Peter and you've heard him, and it's going to be readable. So thank you very much, Peter. We really appreciate you being with us. Have a good one.
You're very welcome. It's good chatting with you.
Thanks for listening to Core Brain Journal. We're working every day behind the scenes to bring you reports that connect research benches with those street trenches. Here we share the complexity of mind science because, as you know, details really do matter. One of the most pervasive, misunderstood challenges is how commonplace medications, like those written for ADHD, are used so regularly without clear guidelines. If you think you'd like more specifics, take a minute to download my 2-page PDF packed with video links and references on the absolute essentials of how to start ADHD medications. They're easily available at corebrainjournal.com/start. Thanks for listening. Do connect and stay tuned. Together we can make a difference.